When we're ready to sing, we step up the microphones and it comes out something like this.
We came in the studios with Levi's and t-shirts, smoking cigarettes. The older guys were saying they're going to wreck the music business.
In the hardcore producing area, everybody knew what went on there. I mean, everybody knew that the best musicians played in all the sessions, but we as the general public didn't know.
They played so well, and they played so well together.
I was in awe then because of Phil Spector. I pulled my car over the side of the road and said, what am I listening to here?
The musicians were really the unsung heroes of all those hit records.
When I listen to the record, it is so apparent that these guys were just really so good. And you can see why everybody used them.
The Wrecking Crew was the focal point of the music. They were the ones with all the spirit and all the know-how.
We made up a lot of arrangements ourselves.
We would either augment or totally replace a group.
The public was oblivious that there was this secret star maker machinery.
I had no idea that people didn't play their own records until the Monkees came along.
We were so busy.
I was making more money than the President of the United States.
7 records of the year.
It was unbelievable.
Here's the way that the beat goes on sounded when we first heard it. La-di-da-da-da. Yeah, that's uh-oh. The third line I came up with was.
The beat goes on.
They were the stone cold rock and roll professionals, and there may never be a group of that caliber again.
Hello, this is Niswander, and welcome to the Nowman Show. Denny Tedesco is a producer and director who grew up in Los Angeles and graduated from Loyola Marymount University. He started his film career as a set decorator for films such as Eating Raoul and has worked around the world as a lighting technician and location producer for IMAX Films. He conducts interviews for Annie Biography, TV Land, and Comedy Central. For over a decade now, he's produced commercials, videos, and promos, including the 2000 Academy Awards opening segment with Billy Crystal and the Elton John music video, I Want Love, starring Robert Downey Jr. In 2014, he released his documentary, The Wrecking Crew, about the great session players, including his father, Tommy Tedesco, and the rest of the crew that created the music behind the Beach Boys, Frank Sinatra, Elvis Presley, the Monkees, TV show theme songs, and so much more. Denny Tedesco, welcome to the Nowman Show.
Thank you.
Now, you grew up in a household with a father who was a world-class session musician.
I did, but, you know, I was just like any other dad.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody assumes it was like a hootenanny at our house, you know, a lot of music and yeah. Rock and roll and all that. But the truth is, dad just went to work like everybody else. I was born in 61, so I didn't see my dad play guitar at home for himself until 74, 75.
Really?
Maybe even 76, because he did jazz albums then. Because he was going to work when we were kids, he was going to work 10, 12, 14 hours a day just playing, so he didn't need to practice. So when he got home, it was, you know, be with the kids, be with the family, watch football, card game, or whatever it was, but it wasn't music. So I had a different life than other people think I did.
Yeah, yeah. Did you want to play music?
Oh, yeah. I wanted to play a lot of music. I could have been a one-man band with all the things I took. Guitar, piano, saxophone at Notre Dame High School. That was to get out of typing class. Never actually played with the band. Accordion, I quit that too. No, I'm a quitter.
You're a quitter.
I was a quitter. I can't play an instrument now.
So what made you actually want to get into the film business?
That's interesting. When I was in high school at Notre Dame in Sherman Oaks, I got cast in a Pizza Hut commercial. So that was my touch of acting, and, you know, thought I wanted to go that way. And did that, and it was fun, and I was doing plays, and then I went to Loyola Marymount for production, and I wanted to be a writer there. I was trying to write scripts, and, you know, wrote a few scripts, and, you know, optioned one, but I wasn't a writer. It was, you know, same thing with musicians. You have to do it every day. If you don't have that love of doing it every day, a writer needs to write every day. A musician plays every day, whether or not, you know, but they have to do it. And that wasn't me. So the Wrecking Crew, I started in 96, you know, the story about my father and his friends. And it wasn't until this year that we got it out.
Wow.
So there's part of that is the backstory of quitting all those other things. I thought, I can't quit this.
And eventually you knew you would get to that story.
Yeah.
So at the beginning, you became a location manager.
Well, I was actually gripping and lighting at the time, and IMAX Films, when I started doing that, did that for a few years. And then 96, my dad was diagnosed with cancer, and it was terminal cancer, and I just remember them saying he doesn't have much time, and I wanted to do something about the crew. And so we quickly put together a round table like this and just started shooting. And it was a wonderful, wonderful day.
So to get back, before we go on to the Wrecking Crew, what was it like doing the IMAX films? You must have had a lot of adventures.
I loved it. I mean, you know what it was? Because why I loved it so much was there was only three or four of us sometimes at a time. We would go, the first job was going to Japan, you know, to do volcanoes.
Really?
And there was, you know, a volcano down there that it was called Ring of Fire. It's like, I thought I was never going to get that job, you know, but I got the job. But why I loved it so much is because you became part of decision making. And, you know, when you're 33% of the crew, you know, you go, oh, look at that. And we all look, and, you know.
Yeah.
Versus, you know, in town here, you know, you're just throwing a sandbag sometimes. It wasn't so much fun. But I got to learn how to dive. Great Whites was my second dive in Australia. You know, spent 3 weeks on a boat there. Went to China or Taiwan. Went to Alaska to do up and down the state, you know, filming grizzlies and polar bears and everything.
Wow.
And Serengeti in Africa was my favorite.
Wow.
Yeah, spent a good three or four months there, on and off throughout the year, watching a migration.
The migration of
wildebeest.
Wildebeest. Wow.
So we would, you know, just sit out in the bush, just waiting for them to cross a river, and sometimes you just started rooting after 2 weeks, nothing happened. You start rooting for the crocodiles. you just got like, come on, do something.
What was you say that was your favorite?
I think so. It's just, it was an amazing. I mean, I was able to do things I thought there's no way I could ever do in my lifetime.
Yeah.
You know, to be, you know, sitting in, you know, in Africa or in Alaska, in the top of, you know, Barrow, Alaska, you know, just sitting on the ice.
Wow.
You know, so I was very fortunate. You know, I loved it.
And then you also did interviews.
Yeah, I mean, the interview started because once I stopped doing IMAX films, I started producing some rock and roll videos for a couple friends here and there, and someone recommended me to a job on Comedy Central. It was a show called Pulp Comics, which was a fantastic show, and it was basically stand-up comics would do their stand-up in New York, and then we would do the films that it's like Amy Schumer's show right now, and you would do the films that related to the stand-up, and I got to meet Dana Gould, who's fabulous, and David Alan Greer, and Margaret Cho, and it was fun. And that started my producing career. So I went that way into comedy, and then started doing a lot of comedy stuff for producing for a game show network, as well as Comedy Central, where we do promos for them. I loved it. You know, comics. I have a soft spot for comics because I feel it like musicians. You know, there's something that they're putting themselves out there, but I think comics have to do it even more because, you know, a musician can play in a club and, you know, for the they don't have to pay attention to him.
That's right.
God help that person. You know, he or she better get some response. You know?
Exactly.
So I have a soft spot for them.
Excellent. And so you you actually got an Emmy nomination for a segment that you did Academy Awards in 2000 with Billy Crystal?
they had an Emmy nomination. I was recommended to come and be the outside producer of this show called the Billy Crystal film, they called it. It was when Billy came back after a few years and to do the opening. And Billy had already done those two openings where he put himself into the five films nominees. And I think this was 2000, if I'm correct. They wanted the top 15 films, you know, of the century.
Wow.
So we, you know, put Billy in with Charlie Chaplin in The Godfather, and it was fun.
Wow.
You know, and that was the stuff that doesn't make it to at the writer's table, that doesn't make it to the film, is always much funnier. It's pretty funny.
I think I remember seeing that. That was very well done.
I mean, that was you know, Dakota Films did that, and they were the guys that did all that stuff. They knew how to do it. I just helped, you know, just make sure it got together.
What was it like working with Elton John and Robert Downey Jr.?
I didn't work with Elton.
Oh, you didn't?
No, it was interesting. The Elton John video, again, was one of those jobs where it came out of nowhere. It was a recommendation. Somebody from England called, said, it was somebody we knew, said, hey, it's Thursday. Can you cover me on a producing job on Tuesday? I said, sure, what is it? Well, it's Elton John video. I said, oh, well, wow, that's great, but Elton's not in it. Okay. And then she went on to say, I said, well, is it prepped? Is it ready to go? She goes, no. I said, but it shoots on Tuesday. And it was basically, the story is, it's one shot from beginning to end. And she says, it's all it is, it's just one shot. You know, the actor is going to sing to the part. I said, who's the actor? And she said, Robert Downey Jr. I said, Robert's in jail right now. He's in rehab. I mean, you know, just after Ally McBeal.
Yeah.
And she goes, well, they're going to let him out for this. I said, oh, no. And it was great, but
wow.
It's like, are you kidding me? We had to prep and shoot that in literally 3 days, had to get it together. And it worked out. It was one of the most, if you get a chance, listen to that song. It's gut-wrenching, because it's, especially with Robert's lip sync in it, you believe he's singing it. It's a beautiful song.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yep, now, when we come back, we're going to talk about The Wrecking Crew.
Sure.
So we're going to take a little break, and we'll be right back.
This is Nowman. I am the superhero of the present moment and the host of The Nowman Show.
I'm Andrew Keegan, and when I'm in L.A., I watch The Nowman Show.
We have all kinds of interesting stuff. Education.
Think about it.
Entertainment.
Hi, my name is Erica Podest, and I'm a scientist at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. And next time I'm in Pasadena, I'll be checking out The Nowman Show.
Music, film,
get down, get funky.
Hi, my name is Philip Carrillo. I'm a filmmaker. And each time I'm in Los Angeles, I'm watching The Nowman Show.
We're on location.
Hi, I'm John Fugelsang, and when I'm in L.A., I like to buy lots of shoes and not walk anyplace. But also, I like to watch The Nowman Show because it is better than the best show on all of TV.
The Nowman Show is also on YouTube. Now!
All right, back here with Denny Tedesco. As we mentioned earlier, his father, Tommy Tedesco, was an acclaimed studio session musician. And you did a film called The Wrecking Crew, which you produced, co-produced, I should say, and directed, correct?
Right.
And now it's in theaters, it's getting outstanding reviews, it's actually an award-winning documentary. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Absolutely, I love it. And so we're going to watch an outtake right now to start this conversation with Leon Russell talking about working with George Harrison.
I was playing on one of George Harrison's records one day, and we were in take 168. And I went up to him and said, George, do you want me to play the same thing 168 times, or do you want me to play 168 different things? This is driving me crazy. I didn't like to do that. But some people, I mean, he was overdubbing on my wedding album. I had one of his songs on there. He just played a guitar solo. And it was great. I said, well, that's good. And he said, oh, no, that's not quite good. Let me play it again. So he played, I had a 40-track machine. And he played 25 more solos. I kept all of them. And we got to the end of solo 25, and I said, well, George, listen to this one, see what you think. I played it. He said, well, that's great. What is that? And I said, that's number one.
All right, Leon.
Yeah, phenomenal guy.
Yeah. So you interviewed him towards the end of the production?
Yeah, absolutely. See, I started, like I said earlier, I think it started in 96. What happened was when we started this film, I tried everywhere to try to get funding. Mm-hmm. You know, in 1998, Dad died in 97, so I kept going with this 14-minute piece. And everybody said, this is great, but you'll never get it made. And they said two reasons. One, you're never going to get the publishers and the record companies to come together to be part of this. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And second of all, the cost it will be for the music itself will be much higher than a documentary could ever make. So that's a lost cause. So I had to keep on going for, it was about 10 years, and my wife finally figured out, well, she didn't figure out, we knew. Did we just make the most expensive home movie ever? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And it was like, what do we do? And I describe it as having a property overlooking this wonderful beach, and you have nothing but the property. You have the plans, you have the appliances, you know, everything, but you can't, until you build it, you have no idea if you can sell it. So we got Claire Scanlon, who's a wonderful editor, and now she's a director on TV. She came on and she helped, you know, she edited and helped me produce it. And so 2008, we got into the festivals. Did extremely well, but no one would touch us because we still had at least $700,000 worth of, you know, licensing. And I just had to keep on going. No one, you know, finally it was 2010, we started doing donations. Mm. We came up with donation ideas. If you pick a song in the film, you could, for $1,000, you could put a dedication on it. And great. That started it. So it was like putting a name on into a building. And we raised over $500,000.
Wow.
Between, you know, $5, $10, up to $50,000, you know.
People That's fantastic.
Helped out. But it took many years. And, you know, I'm really proud of it. And then Leon, we interviewed Leon in 2012, I think it was. You know, so the film had already done the festivals, but I was still hoping to get this released. And when we did Kickstarter, which was our last thing we did in 2013, which was to raise money to pay off the musicians union, which they got paid, we were able to use the money, some of the money, to add Leon's interview in.
That's excellent.
It's phenomenal. I mean, Leon, people don't realize, Leon and Glenn Campbell were two of the greatest session players of all time.
Yes.
But, you know, they were the only ones really that became stars.
Exactly.
You know, went on their own. And Leon was like Leon. He just says it like it is. He was, you know, I asked him, I said, were you ever bored? He said, oh, I was bored all the time.
Yeah, he was bored all the time.
He says, I'd be sitting there doing the tracks and there's no lyrics. You know, we're just doing the tracks. He says, after the 10th time, I've got it memorized in my head. He says, I start writing lyrics in my head.
Exactly.
With this song, maybe it was going to be, you know, a Sonny and Cher song, but he's writing his own lyrics.
Exactly.
So,
and your father, Tommy Tedesco, was described by Guitar Players magazine as possibly the most recorded guitarist in history, right?
I mean, one time it probably could have been, because, you know, Dad had a specialty. He was a session player. When I say that, I mean because he could play multiple instruments. Mm-hmm. He would do, he could play a mandolin, a bouzouki, banjo.
Sitar.
Ukulele. Sitar.
Yeah, electric sitar.
Electric
sitar.
Right. Ukulele. It didn't matter. He said, if it had a string, I'll play it. As long as I tune it, and I'm not a guitar player, but guitar players understand, I tune every instrument like a guitar. You know, he said, if I could tune a shovel like a guitar, I will.
Wow.
You know, and the reason was, then he knew where he was on the fretboard. So if he's, you know, if he said, listen, it's not the traditional tuning, but how am I going to tell John Williams if I'm lost? Because I'm traditional tuning and I'm lost. How am I going to tell him, but it's right? It's not right. It doesn't sound right.
Exactly.
So his job is to get it right.
How did he inspire you, would you say?
You know, it's funny because people assume I play and I don't, as we said. He inspired me how he treated so many people. He inspired me, you know, people tell me stories about him that were phenomenal. He inspired me to never give up and really be smart about how things went, to read a room. He could read the room better than anybody. And I think that's what kept me alive for 19 years making this.
Wow.
You know, he said, never blow up on the leader, meaning like, hey, you could be 110% right about the argument going on, but you blow up on the guy, he's not going to bring you back the next day. And those, that kept me straight for those 19 years when I was negotiating with labels and publishers or whoever, you know, because guess what? You know, 6 years later or 10 years later, I'm talking to that person again.
Exactly.
Yeah, so we luckily I never lost it.
And then when once it was in film festivals, it started getting traction, right? So
yeah, well, it got traction, but it was a darling. That's all it was the darling of the music community, darling mm-hmm. of mm-hmm. festivals. But it didn't mean anything because no one would touch us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Literally, it wasn't until I called Magnolia and said, hey, we're paid up. And they said, oh, really?
Yeah.
Because no one knew it. People thought it was out. And it changed from the original as well. So there was a lot of changes that came
out. And didn't Claire say, who is your editor and co-producer, didn't she say at one point, like, stop interviewing people?
Yeah, well, that was one of the things that Claire said when she came on. And, you know, because don't forget, I had already done 10 years,
mm-hmm.
and I was still interviewing people. She said, you can't keep interviewing people. I said, but, and she was right. She said, you can't put everybody into this. I said, I know, but... because you'll never fall in love with these characters. You need mm-hmm. to know who these are.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, but that's why God gave us DVDs. I said, I will put it on the DVD somehow. And even a couple days ago, I interviewed Bobby Hart of Boys in Heart.
Oh, wow.
I just feel it's historically, I want these things down, even if it's, you know, for YouTube or whatever. If I have a chance to talk to someone, let's put it on.
And while these people are still here, get them on film.
Yeah,
you know,
and I was
you can
lucky.
Always do additional films.
Exactly,
part
you
two,
know,
part three, or however yeah, many you need to
we'll
do.
We'll see about that. But I was really happy because I wanted the voices. I wanted their voices on the DVD. There's 6 hours of extra bonus material, which I had to beg Magnolia to do. And it was like we have Petula Clark, Richard Carpenter, Bill Medley, Barry McGuire, James Burton. Many of the other artists in it, engineers chapter, there's a producers chapter.
Well, let's finish this segment
sure.
with a clip.
Okay.
That actually has your father in it, and Leon Russell is telling, well, actually everybody else is telling the story,
story,
and he's verifying it.
So I know the story. You know what, and it's funny because I never heard this story until Cher and Leon told it.
Wow.
And I wish my father was around just to ask those questions, like, what happened?
Yeah, exactly.
And I never heard it until then.
And here's the clip with Leon Russell talking about a session.
Can you name the piano player in all of these songs?
Gentle on my mind. Little old lady.
When I was playing as a sideman, I kept my mouth shut. I didn't say anything to anybody about anything. Unless I happened to know the arranger or the producer, then I'd say something if I had an idea. But normally, I didn't know anybody. And I just kept my mouth shut.
He had that magic touch on the piano. I don't know what you call down-home, southern-style piano playing that he did. It was magnificent.
And I was so taken with Al DeLore and his capability. And he put Al, later on, he put Al playing electric piano,
yeah.
which was just a fill kind of, I mean, just something to fill up the sound, with Leon Russell playing the acoustic piano. And I said, gee, you know, I thought Al was great. And he says, no, Leon Russell, man, he's got hands. He can reach octaves
yeah,
with
right.
his, you can't beat that.
I figured out early on that if I wanted to be heard on the record, I had to play high. So I always played high. And all those high parts on those Phil's records, it's me. I did that so I could be heard. If you don't do that, you get lost, you know, in the wall, so to speak.
Leo never said boo to anybody, you know, he just come in, play his piano, you know. And so one day he came to work completely drunk. I mean, so drunk, and he went in and he sat down at the piano, and he and who was playing next to him? Don Randy, I think. And everybody, I mean, he was actually talking. He never spoke.
And everybody was like coming in, did you see Leon? And so everyone was like just looking at him, you know, and he was being really funny too, because I never heard him say a word. So Philip was like totally knocked out, but then finally he wanted the session to begin, you know, and Leon was just doing, you know, all this kind of crazy stuff. And so Philip said, you know, Leon, have you ever heard of the word respect? And Leon jumped up on the table, on the piano, and he said, Philip, have you ever heard of the word you? And everybody, I mean, that was, I mean, they couldn't get it together for half an hour. People were like dying on the floor. I mean, tears rolling in the studio, because it was one of those, you know, the weirdest thing you ever saw.
The story, the way Cher told it, the Phil Spector story, that's absolutely accurate. First of all, Tommy was there that day that I did that horrible drunk bonanza on top of the piano at Phil Spector. The next day, Tommy came over to my apartment and said, Leon, said, I want you to go on the road and preach. I'll pay for the whole thing. I'll buy the buses. I'll buy the trucks. I'll pay for every dime of expenses. And you just give me a percentage back to pay me back.
We were on this day with Glenn Campbell, and they brought Leon in, and I'll never forget. And Leon panicked. He was sitting there, and Glenn says, Leon, just play that you did in Oklahoma. He says, they don't know nothing here. So Leon played Leon Russell.
Yeah, right.
And all of a sudden, they don't know nothing. That was his style. That's what they loved. That's what he did from there on it.
I'd play those sessions. We'd play tracks. We have chord sheets. So we'd play tracks. Sometimes we'd play them 10 times before we ever heard the melody, heard the singer. Just out of boredom, I'd write songs to those tracks as it's going by.
You know, those are the surprises I didn't know about over the, you know, 19 years of making the film. Things like that I loved.
And I'm sure you learned a lot about your father and just everything just all at once. The just amazing multiplicity of stories.
Yeah.
And, you know, and when we get into the second part of the Wrecking Crew, we'll talk in more detail about, you know, the people and
great.
And individual stories and even the music business and some other surprises too. So I'm here with Danny Tedesco, and this is the Now Man Show, and stay tuned for part two of the Wrecking Crew story.